Next Life Publishing LLC presents a full cast audio production of Dawning of Darkness, The Fall of Gods and Kings, the first prequel story in the Next Life series. Produced by Next Life Publishing LLC. Cover art by Oleg Belotted. Written, directed, and edited by James G. Robertson.
Hey there, it's your author. Just a quick heads up, there's an epilogue that runs after the credits. I really hope you enjoy the book. If you wouldn't mind, please leave a review. Myself and the cast worked super hard on this. One last note before we begin. This is a work of fiction. Names, characters, places, and incidents are either the product of the author's imagination or are used fictitiously. Any references to actual persons, living or dead, business establishments, events or locales should not be taken as fact.
Above an ancient world beyond the many galaxies, three spheres occupied the edge of our ever-expanding universe. Though these ancient orbs were only the size and brilliance of the Earth's moon, the gods imbued them with a tremendous energy that dwarfs even a quadrillion of its sun. As they swirled in the empty void like fiery wielders' tacks blazing upon a dark canvas, their comforting glow flowed to the world below, nurturing those within it. Though, that is true only for the top half. On the opposite side of the isolated planet that rotates horizontally, not a single moon or satellite planet has existed for many light years. It is a realm with no illumination in its immediate domain, and its only source of luminosity comes from the engulfing spectacle of the cosmos beyond. Though not much, the twinkle of radiation released by these seemingly endless flickers has been enough for its vegetation to thrive. It was in this faded darkness, in a castle surrounded by deep plum-colored vines with sharp magenta thorns, that the gods who inhabited this universe met with another, one who came from beyond this dimension. Broken and bruised, he hoped to gain their favor during the conclave. Though his goal was not so different from their own, his execution of the matter and his response brought forth another great struggle within this realm. We will save the finer details of this meeting for another day, dearest listener. For now, I can tell you that this being brought a great darkness with him, a plague that ravaged this universe, the eradication and corruption of human souls. The events you will learn about in these books are the hidden chronicles of your universe, the records of its wars from the views of your world's heroes, its villains, the gods, and those beyond. Those deemed important enough to remember. You should know it wasn't through malice that your gods made your lives on Earth so hard. If you believe they have mistreated you, then perhaps these stories can provide an explanation, an apology, for why it had to be that way. They did not make your lives hell for the childish notion of testing your faith. And as much as it pained them to make that decision, perhaps that experience will end up being useful to you and your kin in the world after. Could you call this tough love? Perhaps. Unfair? Almost definitely. But this is how it had to be in order to give you and those you love the greatest chance to pull through the coming battles. Chance is a cruel word. And not all of us are destined to live through the struggles ahead. I hope that if you are one of the lucky few who survive the dark forces that lurk within and beyond our universe, that these words will bring you comfort. Some of these decisions have already led to the tragedy of many, but perhaps for you, it will be different. We don't always know what the right decision will be at the time of choosing, myself included. Nor do we always discover the facts before it's too late. Seldom is anything straightforward in this cruel existence of ours. But I hope you'll keep an open mind as you listen to these tales, this history, and that they give you a better chance to outlast the carnage ahead. Be well, children of fate and destiny, and may the vigorous light forever shine brightest throughout us all.
Dawning of Darkness, Chapter 1. The King of the Cobalt Mountains.
Long ago, on a planet that guards the edge of our universe, three moons filled with vigorous white light gleamed down from the dark skies above. On the world's surface, covered by plentiful hills and valleys of blossoming flowers that shimmered brightly with dew, deer, mice, rabbits, and other animals roamed the fields. Here, as with anywhere else, the creatures of the world followed the instinct of their evolutionary wisdom, the knowledge that has taken root in the core of their being from the struggles of their ancestors. In the nearby mountain range on the edge of an extensive forest where the Fae lurk, the human kingdom within the Cobalt Mountains rests on its snowy perch. Men and women throughout the rocky territory wear solemn faces. Here, there are no children, little joy, and only a single infant. No one, other than the newborn, is younger than the age of 16, according to a previous census conducted by the castle guards. Other than being in the mountains, the kingdom has one other unique feature. It surrounds an enormous volcano that rests peacefully at its center, with a towering gray stone castle nestled against it. Everyone that had seen this brilliant structure found it hard to distinguish where the stoic castle ended and where the natural rock of the volcano began. Hidden away from the castle and the land it safeguards, a soothing magma flows beneath the world's crust, providing heat for the nearby hot springs to flourish. It is here, these many years ago, that a certain man bathed in the comforting waters of the castle's encampment. The man, who looked to be well into his 40s, had jet black hair and burn scars along the entirety of his naked body. While moving his hand across the water's surface, his stark blue eyes seemed to sparkle in the reflection. Out of the springs, but still within his reach, a large blade, clean and sharp with a black diamond shimmer, leaned against the wooden enclosure. The sturdy blade, nearly half the width and length of his body, would be impractical for any living human to wield. But this place is not where those of the living dwell. This is a domain for spirits and their kindred. This realm, designated as Afterworld, is the world humans escape to after death. Peaceful as it may seem, with birds chirping in the nearby woodlands, the man in the hot spring wore a defined look of worry upon his restless face. Tears filled his eyes as he sipped a fine sake while looking at the cloudy sky. After a moment, he sat his cup down and struck the surrounding rocks in the water. Removing his hand from the wall to rub his calloused skin, he noticed his fist had left a charred point upon the stone under the waters. He sighed, unaware that someone had approached from behind.
May I join you, Dobrynya?
Startled, he grabbed his blade and spun around, stopping only when recognition stayed his hand. He splashed water on his face with his free hand before placing the blade back down and facing the man. He was dark-skinned, with short, tangled hair. The tips on his scalp were powdery white, and over his broad shoulders he wore a snow leopard's pelt.
Shouldn't you be with Riza?
Riza is sleeping. I'm afraid she's still tired from birthing Raven. Arthur's Lady Guinevere and her protector Galahad have allowed me this visit by watching over them while I'm out.
He answered. The surrounding air fogged with a cold vapor as he spoke.
I expect any man would need some rest himself after their long birthing of your boy. Come, join me, Claven.
Claven removed the elegant pelt he wore, followed by the rest of his clothes. Underneath was a toned and damaged body, but it was considerably less scarred than Dobrynya's. As he entered the waters, Dobrynya squeezed his fist, creating a heat that caused the water's steam to thicken. Claven moved his arms through the opaque mist and looked at Dobrynya. The first thing he noticed were the king's slumped shoulders and bloodshot eyes. He knew he'd been struggling to deal with current circumstances, but he didn't realize how bad it had gotten. It wasn't a sight that many would expect to see from the man, and it caused Claven to hesitate before speaking.
I heard what happened at the outer blockade. I know you think it's your fault for what took place,
but... It is my fault, Claven. I let him go beyond the blockade and into the dark territory alone. Valentine was never a perfect man, but he was someone I looked after, someone I cared about and considered a brother. I didn't know him for as long as I've known Ragnarr, and not much longer than I've known you, but I still... You know, he told me stories of his time in the Kievan Rus, what he called the Soviet Union. He informed me of how the leaders there treated the ancestors of my countrymen. He told me of this, and how he and his family struggled, living in a constant state of fear. Being on the inside, he saw a lot of injustice, and there wasn't a lot he could do about it without the fear of retaliation. After what happened to me on Earth, what happened to my family both there and here, I bonded with him. I don't know what could have happened between then and when he returned, but I thought he was one of us. I thought. It matters not what I thought. He betrayed us all. Valentine deserted us and our gods. There is no redemption. It's done.
You can't blame yourself for him abandoning us. Whatever happened in the Dark Territory isn't on you. Very few have crossed the Dark Gods and survived. The reality is, we don't know what happened.
We may not know what happened there, but he was there on my orders. I thought him being an Alpha would be enough for him to come back with some solid intel. How blind I was. How many deaths of our friends and family has this error in judgment caused? Our numbers were already declining. The Alliance of Man has slowed down the eclipsing darkness. But at this rate, we have to be realistic. Humanity is running out of fighters that can challenge the godly guardians, let alone the dark gods themselves. A few millennia ago, this kingdom alone held close to 20 million citizens. But now? Now it's dwindled to under 2 million. The rate at which souls come to this place versus how many are stolen is at a great disparity. What will happen now that the pillars and the veil supporting the blockade have collapsed?
Collapsed? Listen to what I say, Dobrynya. Was it not him who destroyed the pillars upon his return from the Dark Territory, causing the veil on the outer blockade to fall and allow Flatface and his legions through? There's no defending him. Whatever the case may be, he chose this path. The Realm of Light is in danger more than ever because of his actions. It's hard to accept what has happened, but as you said, it's done. Valentine and those under him have probably donned the Dark Creator's twisted insignia. It's a disgrace. Their forces are breaking through our combined defenses and approaching Three Moons Harbor as we speak. There's not much we can do but wait for the God's command. The Minotaurs and the Divine Mountains await as a final safeguard should Flatface's hordes overwhelm those resisting. Even the Hidden Fairies of the Forest have left their sacred lands and entered the fray, lending their magic to our cause and healing warriors as much as they're able. Their cousins, the Pixies, have been trying to mend the minds of those granted respite by the gods, those strong enough, lucky enough to survive the war as we have. Sometimes even that's not enough, and we, as humans, break.
Dobrynya frowned and touched the top of his own shoulder, feeling the start of the thick scarred flesh that covered most of the skin on his back.
May I?
Clavin asked, pointing to the cup of sake that was half full. Dobrynya nodded and passed his friend the cup. Clavin downed the remainder and sat it to the side before continuing.
It's true that our bodies are a great deal more durable than before, but surely this wasn't how it was to be. We're tired, bruised, scarred mentally and physically. We're in a state of being where our bodies are meant to be free from defects, but they're still marked up and down from this timeless war. Yours more than most, Dobrynya. The gods bless us so that we have no hunger while we fight. But just how many days did you fight without treatment by burning your flesh to keep going? Months? Years of continuous combat?
I can't recall. When you lived as long as I have in this world, time seems to blend.
This is what I mean. You can't blame yourself for what Valentine did, nor what we or the gods must do about it.
You may be right, but if it comes to it, I'm unsure if I'll be able to kill Valentine myself. I will do what I can to protect you and the rest of our people, but this is something that has been weighing on me.
Dobrynya, enough. You've been a harsh teacher, but one hell of a mentor, and damn well beyond a righteous king by saving many of us here. Be strong. If it wasn't for you and Risa, and now my son, I'm not sure I could take this. You've gone through great strives to teach me the way of the sword, and I'm sincerely thankful for that. But don't forget that I'm more than just your student, or a member of your kingdom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.